everybody, and welcome. Let's take our places and open our hearts and minds to God's Holy Spirit. If you're a guest, we'd like to say welcome. We're glad you joined us today and hope you find peace and joy during our worship. Please find the brightly colored paper in the small red folder in the hymnal rack and take a moment to complete that form. Place them in the offering container during that time in our service. Also, if anyone has a prayer request or suggestion for visitation, please use the other portion of that brightly colored paper and hand them to the ushers during the prayers for the people. And then we're going to look at anniversaries. 15th, Joy and George Fink on the 17th. And Tanya and John Metter on the 21st this week. Happy anniversary. And birthdays. Have W.R. Lowe on the 15th. Sybil Philippus on the 18th. Michelle Carson on the 21st. So happy birthday and happy anniversary to all y'all and any that we missed. Okay. Announcements, there's some right in the bulletin. The card ministry is looking for about 150 patriotic cards, so if you can help with that. Two Sundays from now is Make a Joyful Noise Sunday, but we're not going to have a meal with it this time. And I have an announcement from Lydia Circle is going to meet this Tuesday at 7. And next Sunday is family picnic, even more important. Okay. Anybody else? They're from Janet Lindemann. Okay. Anybody else got announcements? Anything to add? Okay. On with our service. Thank you.
Thank you.
you join me for the call to worship? Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord from the heavens. Praise him in the heights.
Praise him, all his angels. Praise him, all his hosts.
Please join me now for the hymn of praise. It's 89. Joyful, joyful, we adore thee. Song we're singing is The Commission.
morning.
Good morning.
This morning, I have a little short game for us to play. So I'm going to show you guys a picture on my phone, and I want you to tell me what you think this person's job is, just based off the picture. And you can just say it when you think of it, okay? But say it where they can hear you, okay? Ready?
Exercising?
Army. Oh. Army. Why do you say army? Oh, because they're wearing a uniform, a military uniform, right? Got camo. What about this one?
Firefighter.
How'd you know they were a firefighter? They've got the firefighter hat on. They've got the uniform on.
I
got
a suit on.
And a suit, a fire suit. Okay, what about this one?
Police officer.
How'd you know it was a police?
Police officer hat.
Yes, got a hat with a badge on. So when people do certain jobs, sometimes they wear a uniform, and it makes it easier for us to tell what they do for a living, right? So I've got a question. How can you tell if someone is a Christian?
Because it says Christian outfit.
A Christian outfit? What does a Christian outfit look like, Ella? It looks like the one you're wearing. It could look like the one I'm wearing. It could look like the one Brother Paul is wearing.
Like a dress or a shirt and pants.
Well, the thing is, Christians wear all kinds of clothes. So it's not like a uniform that you can just look at and say, oh, that person's a Christian. I know because they're wearing a badge that says so. It's not like a police officer. But in our Bible story today, Jesus tells the disciples what they can do so that other people will know that they are Christians. And what he says is, just as I have loved you, you also should love one another. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another. So as Christians, it's not what we wear, it's not what we look like that shows the world what we are. It's how we act and how we love one another and share Jesus and God's love with one another and how we treat each other. So as you go into this week, you need to remember that if you care for people, you're sharing the love of God. Let's bow for a word of prayer. Dear God, thank you for this day. Thank you for these kiddos. And help us go into this week with the reminder that all we have to do to share your love with the world is show compassion and be kind. And that lets the world know we are Christians and share your word with others. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen.
If you would please stand and join me for the prayer for illumination. Lord, open our hearts and minds by the power of your Holy Spirit, that as the scriptures are read and your word proclaimed, we may hear with joy what you say to us today. Amen. Please remain standing for the first scripture.
Our first scripture this morning comes to us from the Gospel of John, 13th chapter, verses 31 through 35. Hear these words. When he had gone out, Jesus said, "Now the Son of Man has been glorified, and God has been glorified in him. If God has been glorified in him, God will also glorify him in himself, and will glorify him at once. Little children, I am with you only a little longer. You will look for me, and as I said to the Jews, so now I say to you, where I am going, you cannot come. I give you a new commandment, that you love one another just as I have loved you. You also should love one another. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another." This is the word of God.
Thanks be to God.
Amen. Please be seated. Our second scripture this morning comes to us in the book of Acts, the 11th chapter, verses 1 through 18. Hear then also these words. Now the apostles and believers who were in Judea heard that the Gentiles had also accepted the word of God. The circumcised believers criticized him, So when Peter went up to Jerusalem, the circumcised believers criticized him, saying, "Why did you go to the uncircumcised men and eat with them?" Then Peter began to explain it to them step by step, saying, "I was in the city of Joppa praying, and in a trance I saw a vision. There was something like a large sheet coming down from heaven, being lowered by its four corners, and it came close to me. As I looked at it, I saw four-footed animals, beasts of prey, reptiles, birds of the air. I also heard a voice saying to me, 'Get up, Peter, kill and eat.' But I replied, 'By no means, Lord, for nothing profane has or unclean has ever entered my mouth.' But a second time the voice answered from heaven, 'What God made clean, you must not call profane.' This happened three times. Then everything was pulled up again to heaven. At that very instant, three men sent to me from Caesarea arrived at the house where we were. The Spirit told me to go with them and not to make a distinction between them and us. These six brothers also accompanied me. And when we entered the man's house, he told us that he had seen the angel standing in his house and saying, 'Send to Joppa and bring Simon, who is called Peter. He will give you a message by which you and your entire household will be saved.' And as I began to speak, the Holy Spirit fell upon them, just as it had upon us at the beginning. And I remembered the word of the Lord, how he said, 'John baptized with water, but you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit.' If then God gave them the same gift that he gave us when we believed in the Lord Jesus Christ, who was I that I could hinder God?" When they heard this, they were silenced, and they praised God, saying, "Then God has given even to the Gentiles the repentance that leads to life." This is the word of God. I want to tell you that very often on a Saturday night, somewhere around 8 o'clock, 10 o'clock, I'm trying to finish up the bulletins that I, you know, may have started on Monday, but didn't get very far all week. Somehow this week, things were different. Now, I was still, about 8 o'clock, finished the bulletins, but that's because, Miss Cynthia, I meant to get the Lydia Circle thing in. And the reason I had saved them from Wednesday when they were finished was in the event that something else needed to be added. Because after 19 years of folks knowing that you can call me on Saturday morning or text me a change, then I can still make it happen because the bulletins haven't yet been run. I didn't see any reason to try and get them done, so I have to say, nope, sorry, they're all done. But this week, God gave me, for some reason, maybe it's the fact that the building of a house is going all right. Maybe it's the fact that I'm no longer dealing with trying to get an automobile finance. Maybe it's the fact that the annual conference is coming up and I don't have anything yet left to do to prepare for it. But I started on the bulletins in earnest on Monday, had them almost done on Tuesday, finished them on Wednesday, and was like, "Boy, Paul, you got this thing down." After only 30 years, you're a quick learner. You figured it out. But there were other factors that I didn't know about coming into play. On Thursday, I had a meeting with the District Committee on Ordained Ministry. That would be D.
D-C-O-O-M. But I often, instead of calling it a committee on ordained ministry, I call it a board on ordained ministry, which makes it B-O-O-M. And because it's district, I have for most of my 30 years called it the D-Boom. Partially because sometimes things blow up there. And those of you who've been around for a long time know that one year I was a subject of some of that blowing up by the D-Boom when they invited me to no longer be a United Methodist pastor. And I managed to do what they asked me to get done, just, you know, kind of by the skin of my teeth. Managed to get enough done. I'm still here. And I appreciate those of you who are here and wrote letters to the district board on ordained ministry and the district superintendent and, I don't know, maybe the bishop. I've never heard about the bishop, but maybe. They are a supervising body. I go see them each year. And they evaluate the ministry. They ask you some questions about how things are going, what's going on. You have Bible studies, how many people do you have in attendance, you know, all those sorts of things. What's your agenda for the next year? What's your agenda for the next 5 years? That one always stumps me. I can barely, you know, plan the next 2 weeks. And I told them those things. And then I got asked a question that in 30 years I've never been asked before. Or at least I don't remember ever being asked before. One of the people there asked Paul, what is it that motivates you in ministry, that keeps you moving forward and doing the things that you need to do? I told him I've got two recent examples, one unfinished and one finished. I told him how there was a young man in his 30s who had called me up after attending one of our worship services. Said, I'd really like to talk to you, okay? Can you come by? That was a little different. Did you want to just talk on the phone? Sure. He sent me the address. I found it after the third time. You know, that Google Maps thing that works great when you pay attention. Explained to me some of his background. He was a drug user. Got busted, spent several years, well, a few years, about three, I think, in the penitentiary. Became a Satanist along the way. Began worshiping Satan. Putting pentagrams and things around the house. And somewhere along the line, realized that his first love, his acceptance of Jesus Christ as a younger man, was where he wanted to go back to. And he moved back to his Christianity. But what we're dealing with right now is that he's afraid for his eternal soul. That because he put idols up, because he worshiped them, because he left his belief of a Christian and became a Satan worshiper, that he had denied Christ, that he had betrayed Christ, and that Christ would therefore never give him eternal life again. Explain to him, but I have yet to explain to him where he can quite accept it. But he's right. God will not give him eternal life again. Not because he's condemned him, like he thinks, to go go to hell. But because the scripture says that God's gifts are irrevocable. Once they have been given, they are given forever. Now, I believe you can deny Christ. I believe you can betray Christ. I believe that you can become apostate, what the scripture calls that. But I also believe that he's gone through all that. He's come to realize and repented of those things and come to realize that he wants Christ in his life. And what he has a trouble believing is that Christ's love and grace and mercy are so strong for him that even doing those things, even cursing God, worshiping one of his creations, Satan, that he could become a Christian, that he could still have a life in eternity in heaven. And I keep telling you, look at this scripture, look at this scripture, look at this scripture, look at all these scriptures that tell you that as you have accepted, it has come to be. It is true and it is complete, and God's side of that is sealed, never to be changed. Now, I personally do not believe that God drags us kicking and screaming into heaven. But I do believe that when we have accepted, God's side of that is absolute. He makes his word true and sure. If I can get this young man to see that, he will be much, much happier in this life and understand more fully where he's headed. That's unfinished business. The other one was finished. I was at a men's retreat in February of this year, and one of the men that was hard-nosed, hard to talk with, we finish up the retreat. Some people have accepted Christ for the very first time. Others have rededicated their lives again. He said, I want to move forward the way I had been before. John was one of those who wanted to be able to do that, but he had part of him that was held back. We're finishing up the retreat. We're coming into a worship service. We're marching two by two down the hallway to go into the sanctuary. And we get to the second to the last door before the sanctuary door, and he just box and gets up against the wall. I can't go there. I can't do that. I am following behind. I see this happen. I pull over. I signal to others to go on. Some of us stop and begin to talk with John. And the difficulty is that he knows Christ, but even in knowing Christ, he has held some anger and some difficulty, and some of that has been toward some of the people that were in the worship service he was about to go to. And he didn't feel that he could go into God's house being a hypocrite, knowing that he still was angry with some of these people that he had some of these folks a decades-long running battle with. And say, oh, praise God, he's good. But I still got this on my heart. We went in the door. We began to talk. some difficulties in our lives. Some of us more than others, right? But few of us watched our mother be murdered in front of us. Now, that wasn't done by anybody in the worship service. But he had good intending Christians. Tell him it's just time to get over it. You've got to move forward. It wasn't helpful. He had good intending Christians tell him, you just don't have enough faith in God. God is good. And you got to see that. Instead, he developed this stone of an angry heart within him. He held that stone for decades. It took four of us talking to him for a while. But he finally did go into that worship service on the second to the last stanza of the last hymn. And came up to his fiancée with a smile. You see, his biggest problem wasn't that God wouldn't forgive him, it's that he couldn't forgive himself. If God has forgiven us, we don't have a right to hold it on ourselves. Let it go. We should give it up. All of that was not intended when I decided what this message was going to be on Monday. Thought it was really important for you to know. And as the week unfolded, I realized that the message I thought I was giving wasn't the one I was supposed to give. You see, John died a week ago today. His fiance holding his hand him on his cancer deathbed. Here's the words I want Paul Beard and that other Paul. Smith is such a tough name, you know. It's hard to do my service. And she asked him, said, that's not who we normally go to, and that's certainly not the closest pastors. He says, I know. But since February, they've both been my pastors. Because they have been more pastor to me since that time than any others. Now I tell the D-Boom, this is what moves me forward. This is why I continue in ministry, because there are opportunities to see that light come on within somebody's brain, within somebody's heart, within somebody's soul, and them understand that God's love, great love, bigger than we understand, bigger than we can know, but we can enjoy. I'm so glad John found his before he got to that bed. And I was honored to be part of the service. And I look forward to seeing him again. Peter is a Jew. And he leaves from Joppa, a Jewish community near the sea. Because he feels this Holy Spirit come. He has this vision of the sheep being lowered and the animals and what is I have made clean is never profane or unclean. And it happens three times. And virtually as soon as it's finished, three men show up. Hey, is Simon here called Peter? An angel of the Lord told us we were to come to this house and ask for Simon called Peter and invite him to come to our house, to my house, and speak to us. These people are not Jews. These people are the outcasts. These people are the leftovers. These people are the other. Now, I don't know about you, but I'm pretty sure my Jewish blood is pretty thin. I'm guessing it is with you, because each of us is pretty much other. We don't have the Jewish blood coursing through our veins. We don't have an inheritance because of the ancestry from which we come. We have an inheritance because Peter obeys the Spirit and goes to a people that are other, that are left out, the dregs at the bottom of the cask. That's us, folks. Oh, we may be well off. We may do good things. We may be all of that. But to the Jewish folks, particularly in Peter's time, we were so much other, we didn't even register on the Richter scale. We certainly didn't register on the righteous scale. But Peter goes. He dines with them. He breaks bread with them. He eats with them. Gives them a message about Jesus and Jesus' love for the world. This is the first time Peter's done this according to Scripture. The man and his whole household believe and are saved. The Holy Spirit comes upon them. Peter comes back to the Jews that he's with, the disciples that he's with. And they're like, what are you doing? You're going over to those people. You're going over to heathens. You're going over to the uncircumcised. You're going over to people who have no Jewish ancestry. You're going over to the Gentiles. Praise God, he did. Because I believe that when Jesus said, you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, in Judea, in Samaria, and to all the ends of the world, what the Jewish voices of our ears of his disciples heard, I believe, was, you shall preach to the Jews in Jerusalem. You shall preach to those in Judea. You shall preach to the few you can find in Samaria. And if you find any scattered out across the globe, preach to those Jews as well. But what Jesus meant was the words he said to everyone. And because Peter answered that Spirit's call, because the man came and found Peter, you and I have heard the word of God and come to accept that word of God for ourselves, come to believe that Christ is our Savior, our Redeemer. Not just for the Jews, not just some 2,000 years ago, but here and now, today, and me. This morning, this moment, let us accept the word of God all over again. Oh, I know. I'm not asking you to be saved again. I'm not asking you to have that Holy Spirit come upon you again. All those things would be great, but you don't need that. You're like that young man that I'm still dealing with. You've already got it. He's already got it. He just needs to proclaim it. He just needs to accept it. He just needs to understand it. He just needs to move forward with where he is. Because he is a strong Christian. He knows Scripture. Been testing me of how my us for some 2,000 years ago. It's for now and 2,000 years and more yet to come. It's for now and for eternity. For that is the word of God. That God's love, grace, and mercy are for each and every one of us. Whether you're here in person, whether you're online listening, God's love is for you. God's love is with you. God's love is there to coax you and call you and help you to know how much He loves and cares for us, each and every one. Amen.
We stand and join me for the hymn of response, Make Me a Captive, Lord, on 421. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword?
No.
In all things we are more than conquerors through the one who loved us. We are sure that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation, will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Amen.
Thank you.
seated. You've had several minutes to fill out those brightly colored sheets of paper with your prayer request on those. If you will hold those up, we will come by and gather those. To remind you, most each week, this will be added. These will be added to our back of our bulletin for the next several weeks after. And I would encourage you to take that with you, set it up someplace. Let it be a reminder, whether you go through that list or not, whether it's just a reminder, let it be a reminder that all the names are there, but at least to be in prayer for each other, to be in prayer for those that you know and those that you don't know. Prayers for the families of those who were shot and killed in Buffalo, New York yesterday. Continued prayers for some rain, some beneficial rain.
Paul?
Yes?
I'm sorry. I've got your chance to write this up. One of my high school teachers, he taught civics and history. All my three little brothers, we all had him. Passed away yesterday. He was 81 up in Electra, close to Wichita Falls. And then I'll ask you for Ray McElroy, is his name. And he had a wonderful influence on us, teaching us patriotism and conservative values. And a wonderful influence on us.
So Ray, what was the last name? McElroy?
M-C-I-L.
Say it again.
McElroy.
M-A-C?
M-C.
M-C.
I-L-R-Y.
M-C-I-L-R-O-Y.
Correct.
Got it. One of the first ways that we show our love for each other is by being in prayer. Let us go in prayer to the Lord. Lord, we give you thanks in the midst of difficulties, inflation in the country, strife across the globe. Those who don't believe you, those who fight against you, those who betray you, those who deny you, including us, Lord, at least at times. We lift up to you, Lord, prayers for healing, prayers for wholeness, prayers for those we care about, the prayers for those we barely know, prayers for those we don't know, Lord. But we know someone else who does, and they've asked for them, we prayed for them. Lord, we pray for us. Give us strength to stand in our faith. Give us courage to shout out how we love you. Give us reason to find helpfulness for others to come to believe. And Lord, above all, continue to give us your grace, for it is like a baby. We need it every day. Lord, these things we ask. We lift up to you the prayers of our lips as well as those of our hearts. In the name of our redeeming Lord, the one who came and saved us, the one who will come and save the world if they will just by grace through faith come to him. Jesus, the one who taught us how to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. As a forgiven and reconciled people, a people of faith and of practice, we offer ourselves to God and God's service. I said we offer ourselves to God and God's service. One of the ways in which we do that is through our morning offering. If the ushers would come forward at this time. Lord, bless both gift and giver. Bless them to the increase of your kingdom. Bless them to the glory of your name. Amen.
Join me with a hymn of dedication, I Know Whom I Have Believed, page 714 in the hymnal.
Thank you.
forth in the joy of God. Go forth in the love of God. Go forth in the service of God the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen. Amen.